Today on the Perception in Action podcast, my interview with Fabian Otte from the German Sport University in Cologne. How can coaches develop their own periodization plan using the periodization of skill training framework? So it's time for a call to action. Hi, everyone. This is Rob Gray from ASU and PerceptionAction.com. Welcome to the Perception in Action podcast, where I discuss how psychological research can be applied to improving performance, accelerating skill acquisition, and designing technologies. In today's episode, my interview with Fabian Otte. Fabian is a PhD student and soccer goalkeeper coach. He is also the lead author on the paper I discussed back in episode 168, looking at periodization of skill acquisition. Fabian and his colleagues developed the periodization of skill training or POST framework. I wanted to bring him on to talk more about this very popular topic, focusing in particular on how coaches can apply their framework to their practice design. Hope you enjoy. So today I'm joined by Fabian Otte from the University of Cologne, the German Sport University of Cologne. Thanks for taking some time to talk with me, Fabian.
No worries. I'm happy to be on the podcast.
Yeah, so can you tell us a little bit about your background and how you got interested in sports science?
Yeah, so where do I start? So the last 10 years, I've been a little bit of a globetrotter in terms of soccer and education. So I've played as a soccer goalkeeper in Germany, England, the Netherlands, New Zealand, and the United States. And while I've been around playing myself, I've actually studied at university. So in the United States, I've been at North Carolina State University on a soccer scholarship. So I've been there for 3.5 years, studied sport management. Then while I was playing in England, I've studied marketing at the University of Newcastle. And then, finally, when I moved back to Germany to be a full-time coach for TSG Hoffenheim in the Bundesliga, I started doing my PhD at the German Sport University in Cologne.
So, the main reason we want to talk about today is your paper that I already mentioned on one of my earlier episodes about the periodization of skill acquisition.
Yeah.
So to start off with, why do you think we need to periodize skill acquisition? Kind of what's your general view on that?
So, I think, first of all, I have to give a shout out to my supervisors, Stephanie Klatt and Sarah Kate Miller from the German Sport University and from Auckland University of Technology. And together with those two, we've done the periodization model. And the origin is quite interesting. So taking it a few years back, when I started working for New Zealand football as the women's national team goalkeeper coach, we were in the year after the Olympics. So we had 4 years for the new cycle to prepare our goalkeepers and our team for the coming Olympics, which would be Tokyo, which unfortunately got postponed. So we had this unique time frame where we had 2 years without any major competition. So we were quite open in our training environment and we could just really focus on skill learning and development because there wasn't any immediate performance pressure. And this is where I also got across Damien Farrow's and Robertson's SAP framework for the first time. And I started thinking about how can I develop our goalkeepers in New Zealand systematically and plan our training in the best possible way, because we have this time frame where we can really focus on learning and development and we don't really have to worry about any performances in that moment. And this is how it all started. So we had 2 years and I could start planning over a longer time span. And then when I moved to Germany 2 years ago to work in a professional soccer club with a week-to-week game schedule, everything moved towards a weekly periodization plan. So I had this long-term plan set up from New Zealand, and then moving into German football where we play every week, I had to move this into a weekly plan, because obviously when we play on a Saturday, it's performance pressure. Like the boys have to go out and win because a lot of money is on the line, there's spectators, the boys want to present themselves in the best way. So when game day comes, there's performance pressure. But I still thought we need to get skill learning into our training week. And this is how I try to move or scale it down to a weekly plan. And then eventually we took it down to a training session plan as well. So this is how it all evolved from like a month-long plan to a weekly plan and then to single training sessions.
Yeah, that's great. And the framework that you developed with your collaborators is the POST framework.
Yes.
So can you tell us a little bit, just kind of a general overview of what's involved in that?
Yeah. So first of all, it's a different coaching contexts that we look at. We look at specialist coaching, which is, yeah, if you think about basketball or baseball or American football, there's a lot of specialist coaches, same in soccer, like quarterback coaches, like goalkeeping coaches, what I am. So there's these coaches that work with single players or with subgroups, and they don't work with the entire team. And most research actually looks at head coaches working with an entire team, how you can implement game-based methods into your training environment. But specialist coaches like I am are often constrained in the work because we have sometimes limited time with the athletes. We have quite limited group sizes. Like, for example, often I train with two players, with two goalkeepers, and it's going to be quite difficult to replicate an 11 versus 11 with three people. So we're quite constrained in this regard. But I always thought about how can we make the best out of this training environment to still enhance skill learning over a longer time period. And this is the context of the post framework. And then in regard to the theory, basically for all the work we've done so far, we've applied an ecological dynamics approach and then combined this with nonlinear pedagogy and the constraints-led approach and principles out of this. And what the post framework initially does is really looking at how can skills be taught by specialist coaches. So these coaches working with single athletes or smaller subgroups of athletes. And eventually, how can we affect goal-directed behavior through the design of training sessions? And yeah, just to put it as a bold statement, with this post framework, training session designs are the main teacher for athlete search and exploration within the training environment. Mm-hmm. So by trying to really nail down the training design, the athlete should be able to search for functional movements and for task solutions in a way that the coach basically is done working, in an ideal world, obviously. That the training design is so successful in what it gives to the players that they have to search and explore without the coach intervening, really. And then finally, we broke the framework down to three skill training stages, how we call them. So again, the goal of the specialist coach is really individualized training. So I have a chance to work with an individual athlete and really try to look at what does this individual athlete need. And in comparison, yeah, the head coach with, let's say, 22 to 25 players doesn't have this luxury because they have to manage an entire team. And as a specialist coach, again, I can really go into individualized talent development or skill development. And then we have these three training stages, coordination training, skill adaptability training, and performance training, as we called them. And this is probably the key part of the model, coaches understanding the different stages. So if we just explain those briefly, for coordination training as the first stage of the model, we would define it as a way of stabilizing general movement coordination and really enhance or like driving exploratory activities. So athletes really try to perceive the relations between system degrees of freedom. So in simpler terms, body components like hands and arms, and really to manage information and action couplings. So bring those two together. And the coach's role in this first training stage would be really to manage the training environment and potentially destabilize it or make it easier by simplifying tasks or by manipulating task constraints. And then we have the second middle skill training stage, which we call skill adaptability training. And this is when athletes get more advanced, we try to confront them with more complex and varied learning environments. And eventually the goal in this training stage is to improve perceptual cognitive skills that eventually regulate adaptive movements. So to put it in simple terms, we try to make skills more robust under increased noise or increased perturbation. Mm-hmm. And in this training environment, we really try to destabilize movements again to make them more adaptable. And then finally, we have the performance training stage, which makes everything a little bit more stable again, because in this training stage, which for professional athletes is very important, closer to games, you try to prepare perception, cognition, actions, and everything for competition so that you're ready to perform. And then there's like some catchwords that we've just taken out of another study, like mental readiness, match fitness, confidence, for example, that provide stability for athletes right preceding competition. So this would be this performance training stage. So that's basically the core of the framework. And then we try to apply a few principles to training planning in the end. One of them, a key one, is representative training designs, which comes from nonlinear pedagogy. So we always try to make our training as game representative as possible. Obviously, I've talked about the limitations that we have as specialist coaches. So we can't always make it 100% representative, just given the numbers that we train with, but we still try to implement some principles. And then the second major pillar would be task or information complexity. Because, like, you know, Rob, something could be really difficult for me in training, but it could be quite easy for you because you are more advanced, you've done something more often than I have. So this, yeah, this concept of information complexity is quite individual and quite subjective. And it's an important part of a coach to understand what is my individual athlete, because I have the luxury to work with an individual athlete. Think about this training exercise and how complex is it for him or her. And then I have to really go in and adjust it in a way that I can make it harder if it's too easy, or I can stabilize it and make it easier again if it's too complicated. Mm-hmm. And yeah, so this is basically the framework, the skill training stages and the few principles that we try to apply to it.
Yeah, I really like that. You know, as a coach, often you get so little time with athletes, right, in the grand scheme of things. And so maximizing it by having such a rich plan. So you mentioned the coaches, you know, I often say moving away from being an instructor to more of a designer of a training environment. Yeah. But you sounds like there's also a big role during the actual practices in terms of adapting if you have to, right? Yes. The complexity. Also, is there a big role for assessing to see, you know, which stage you're at and whether you're on the kind of the right part of the, you know, the trajectory in the periodization? How do you kind of assess where you are and whether it's working or not?
So I think a lot goes through observation. Mm-hmm. So another key principle of nonlinear pedagogy and the constraints-led approach, you design a training environment, mm-hmm. and you're not going in as a coach and telling the players what to do and how to solve problems. You let them search for solutions. And what I do as a coach then is I observe what they're doing. And I get a quite good feeling after a few minutes. Is it too complicated? Is it too easy potentially? And what could be the problem? So this is where this nonlinear approach comes in. I plan a training session, but after 5 minutes, I might change my entire plan because I either have to jump back the training stage or sub-stage. So I may go from skill adaptability to coordination training. Or I move up a training stage and make it more complicated. And this again goes through observation. So it's quite subjective. It has to do with experience, trial and error as a coach as well. Learn from mistakes, learn from experience. But over time, you get a quite good feeling, and you get a feeling for certain exercises or designs and training that you do and how individual athletes respond to them. And then, yeah, you have to go in and make changes if needed.
Yeah, no, that's really great. One of the things I really like about your model is it captures the nonlinearity, you know, that you might have to take a jump back in a few stages at some point, even though you've seen progress. And yeah, the one point I wanted to pick up on is the representative learning design. I often get questions from people, you know, how representative is representative enough, right? You know, you work with soccer goalkeepers, you know, do you need to always have a full-size field? You mentioned the number of players, you know, how do you decide how far away you can go? Obviously, the goal is always to be as close as possible to competition, but you said, you can't always do that. And to work on certain parts of the skill, sometimes you have to sacrifice representativeness. So how do you think about that in your framework?
So yeah, like exactly like you said, 100%, you always try to be as representative as possible, full stop. Mm-hmm. But then the detailed answer would be probably the classic answer. It depends. Mm-hmm. Depends on various factors. Like, for example, the skill training stage. Are we, for example, in our training week, are we in a Tuesday training session where we have 4 days till the next game? So we can really push the guys and really work in a complex training environment, having a lot of mistakes so we can learn from our mistakes and really try to push this phase? Or are we in a Friday training session really preparing for the next game? So this definitely has huge impact whether we try to be really, really representative or if we try to stabilize the training environment and make it quite easy. Then the number of athletes, like you said, very important. If I have one goalkeeper in a training session, so a one-on-one session, it's almost nearly impossible to create a game representative environment. What you could do is use task and environmental constraints like the 16-yard box or 18-yard box, for example, to have these markers on the field to give a sort of idea. But the training exercises that we do itself are quite unrepresentative, if you want to say. Then another factor would be the time I have with the athletes. If I have 15 minutes and then they join the team training, which is really representative, full stop, I wouldn't really try to push those 15 minutes and make something really complex happening. I would rather prepare them, make them feel good for the training that will actually drive all the learning for them. And then obviously other factors in professional sports, like physical loading, individual athlete circumstances, like is there maybe family problems for that goalkeeper, or did he have a really bad last game and he needs to perform in the next game? So do I really want to take down complexity for him in that week because he needs to feel better because he's just really frustrated? Or the other way, he had a really good game, so I can push him in a really complex way. So these are all factors that limit representativeness, but we still try to implement a few guidelines in every training. Mm-hmm. And yeah, one key idea of the ecological dynamics approach is, and you will know this for sure, information regulates action. And that's obviously a big foundation of skilled performance. So what we try to do is always couple perception action in every exercise that we do. So just to give you an example of traditional, more old school goalkeeper training, mm-hmm. a lot of times the goalkeeper coach goes in and tells the player where he's going to shoot the next ball. So I would tell the goalkeeper, I shoot the ball to the right bottom corner the next 10 times. So the goalkeeper knows exactly what's happening mm-hmm. and just executes the movement over and over. So it's this classical approach of just, yeah, automizing the movement performance. But we try to go the other way. We try to integrate perception, action, cognition, and emotion in one holistic manner. And yeah, try to allow for athletes to search within this training environment for high quality information. So when I run up to shoot the ball, they have to try to perceive certain markers from my body, for example, my hip position, to really perceive information and then coordinate the action accordingly to what I'm doing, where I'm shooting. So we try to keep this intact all the time. So even when I train with one goalkeeper in a one-on-one situation, I can still drive these principles. And then another principle, I've briefly mentioned it, the coach, like me, I'm not the main problem solver. So I'm not going in and training and telling the goalkeeper what to do. Goes a little bit into what I've said with, I tell the goalkeeper where I shoot. I'm not trying to do this. I'm trying to not tell the goalkeeper where I shoot. So the goalkeeper has to solve the problem, see where I'm shooting, perceive the information, and then coordinate the movement. Same goes for feedback and instructions, for example. Maybe I pose a challenge, like, can you do this or this? And then I'm not going in first thing and telling the goalkeeper or the player what to do. Like, I'm not giving direct feedback and giving the answer. I want the players to really search for the answer and explore and fail maybe and then try again and really, yeah, analyze what they've done in a way that they couple perception and movements together. So this is like key principles that independent, if I have 1, 2, 5, 10 players, I can always try to integrate, which make the training a little bit more representative. But 100% representativeness is always difficult for specialist coaches.
Yeah, I would say. Yeah, definitely. Yeah. And I think you have a lot of good points there. You know, a couple for me, I think you're right. The representative, a couple key things are trying to keep the variability of the action, yeah. like it's going to be right, not too predictable and doing the same thing. And then yep. the information, right? You know, don't do a drill where you're, as a coach, you're throwing the ball at the keeper. Right. Keep the kicking yeah. action. So right, yeah. anytime. So keep that real information there as much as possible. I also really like that you recognize that not every training session is about acquiring skill and developing. Some of them are just motivational, yeah. right, to make them feel good.
Exactly.
Yeah. So what I wanted to turn to next is, you know, so that's, I think, a really good explanatory model. And I think I talked about kind of the theory behind it in my episode. But what I wanted to focus more on for people to listening today is the application of this, which you do have a really yep. good section at the end. So if someone wants to, you know, I have a coach that really likes this idea and they want to use the POST framework, what's the first place to start with this for their sport?
Mm-hmm. So I think personally, so when I started developing this together with my colleagues, what really helped me is understanding the skill training stages. So obviously it's taken from Newell's model of motor learning, those three stages that he uses, and really understanding those stages helped me a lot to understand where my athletes at. And if I can challenge them a lot, or if I have to stabilize their movements and make them, like you said, motivational training, make them feel good. And what we've tried in the model is using three colors. blue for coordination training, green for skill adaptability, green for growing, and then red for performance training, which is more like you have to be alert, you have to be ready to perform now. And what I really try with those colors is make it simple for players, for example. So my goalkeepers, for example, know the three colors. They don't know the theoretical details behind the skill training stages, but they know, for example, when we go into training and I say, today we train in the green stage and it's quite complex, they know, okay, we're going to fail a lot. But they also know, because this took quite a while, but I educated them on why it's important to fail a lot in training, because it's about learning and development. And then on the other hand, when we have a training session 2 days before the next game comes up, and I say, today we train in the performance stage in red, they know, okay, we have to be really sharp because every information we get will be opponent related. So it's performance preparation. But the training environment itself is likely not going to be as complex, and they're not going to be challenged with very, very difficult situations, because I want to stabilize the movements and make them feel good. So this is probably the best starting point. And then lastly, I think, reading some, there's some great papers, obviously, on motor learning theory and skill acquisition, and some great books as well. Just diving more into those concepts that we try to use in the framework, like game representativeness, representative learning designs, or task complexity, for example, and movement variability, what you mentioned earlier. There's some really good concepts that, if like as soon as you understand those, your training environment becomes a lot more effective, I would say, just because I think, and it's independent of the sport, players don't learn motor skills in different ways in different sports, really. It's just the design can be similar and you can have really effective learning environments. So yeah, just to keep it short, skill training stages would probably be the start.
Yeah, I think that's really good. I like, it makes you think about what's the purpose of all the, every yeah, training session exactly. If you do that coloring. Is that just a step back to the coordination stage? I know there's a very different theoretical framework and how we're doing it, but is that kind of approximately equivalent to focusing on technique in the old kind of model, you know, where you're just focusing on the basic movement patterns? I don't know. I had someone ask me. It's not, obviously, you're doing it in a very different way, because you're not trying to get them to do one ideal movement. You're never in the, your model, you're never really doing that at all. I don't, so maybe not.
I think I see how people would perceive this, and it's not totally wrong. Like, you try to stabilize certain movement patterns mm-hmm. that are proven to be functional, like you said, in a variable way. Like, everybody, there's no ideal movement to solve the task, but what is important for this stage as well is the valid training environment. So having a representative training environment. So I'm still dribbling and shooting off the ground. Like what you said, I'm not trying to throw the ball. So I try to keep certain information variables in the training environment, but I take it right down. So I might dribble really slow and do my step towards shooting the ball really slow for the goalkeeper to have a lot more time to perceive what I'm doing and get ready, get set, and then try to catch the shot. And I'm not going to shoot as hard. So it's a sort of technical training, but in a very representative environment. And I'm still not going to go in and do these classic block drills where I do 150 repetitions of one movement and then we go to the next one. It's still quite representative in a way that you have to perceive what's happening and then execute a motor action that can differ between trials.
Yeah, no, I think that's a really good way to put it. Yeah. You've identified these, you've colored your training sessions, the green, red, and blue, like you said. As a coach, how do I take into account, you talked a little bit about this at the start, kind of the micro and macro cycle, how do I take into account the different training? So certain sports like basketball or baseball here in America is the worst, where you play all, every other day or almost every day. How do you take into account that? I'm assuming you kind of work backwards from the game, right? And I'm assuming you almost always want the performance, the red, closest to the game. And then if you have time, you fit the other ones in. How do you kind of work that out when you're planning?
Yeah, I think that's a very good point. You have to look at what advancement level your athletes are in. Are they professional athletes? Because that's the ones that I work with right now. So the game is hugely important. They have to win the games because, like I said, money is on the line. There's fans and media and pressure and TV rights and everything. So there's a lot on the line. So the game is critical. You have to win the games as many as possible, as often as possible. And you have to perform well. Then on the other hand, youth athletes, you might argue that the game is not the most important part, because in those 4 or 5 training sessions that you have throughout the week, you can develop a lot more than in those 60 minutes game time that you have, for example. So this is important to really look at what athletes do I have. And for the professional space, the game, like you said, is the starting point. So I put in the big 6 month calendar, I put all our game dates. And then I count back, basically. The day before game is always performance training, just to make them feel good. Often the 2 days before the game is also performance training, because our head coach often plays 11 versus 11 and it's opponent driven. So we do video analysis on the opponent and we try to do a lot of technical things in the 11v11. So it's quite game representative, but it's performance focused, because the athletes need to understand what is the opponent doing, how can I act against it. So it's a little bit this global to local direction of self-regulation of team units. And then I take it back day to day. And the start of the week often is our skill adaptability training sessions, when we have a few days before the game starts and we can really focus on skill learning. So this is how I do it for the pro space. Again, if you talk about youth development and youth athletes, I think you can be a lot more aggressive with putting skill adaptability training days into the calendar. The game obviously has an impact, because it's a huge factor for motivation and keeping kids in the game and keeping them enjoy being successful and everything. But I think you could be, as a coach, more pushing for the skill adaptability part in that age group. And then if you talk about, it's an interesting one with all the games like you mentioned in baseball. Mm. Next year, I will find out as I'm moving to the Premier League in England, and there's a lot of soccer matches every week as well. So that will be interesting. But I personally firmly believe that there's always a day or two in a week for skill adaptability training, because if you think about specialist coaches again, there's always players that haven't played the last game, so they need more training. There's always players that come back from an injury, so they need more training. Or there's always players that want to train more because they feel like the game wasn't demanding enough and they want to do more. So there's always a way, I think, for specialist coaches, especially, to do certain forms of training and challenge the players. So I think, and it has to be really individual, obviously, on the team context, on the game schedule, on the whole environment that the club works in. But I think you can apply the model to any training environment, professional or amateur level, if you want.
No, I think that's a great way to think about it, just what the athlete is and the time you have. And I wanted to ask, so in the skill adaptability phase, you mentioned one of the main ones, type of things you're using is constraints-led approach, constraints manipulation. Yep. Can you kind of walk us through, how do you go about developing a constraints manipulation for a practice session? Is it, I know that's a really open question because there's so many different ways to do it, but I think that's what a lot of people are kind of struggling with. Do you start with a specific athlete that you want to, something you want to work on about their performance, or just kind of more general? What can you talk a little bit about that?
I think that's one big part that you mentioned. It's coming from two sides. One side is the athlete itself. Mm-hmm. So again, luckily, I often work with 2 or 3 players, so I can be quite targeted on what each individual player needs. And through working with those guys every day, basically, I know them quite well, and I can, I have the chance to speak to them a lot and know how they feel and know what they want and know what they need for their performance preparation, for example. So the individual athlete is a big part. And then on the other part, it's the game itself. So if we say we want to work on a certain part of the game, for goalkeepers could be defending the goal, quite simple. Mm-hmm. You could put it that way, which is obviously a main task for any goalkeeper. Then we orientate our training based on game scenarios. So certain situations or patterns within the team take constraints down from the game environment. So we take the 11 versus 11 as a starting position, knowing that we can't replicate that in goalkeeper training. But then, like what I've said, we try to use this 18-yard box, for example, as a starting point. If we focus on defending the goal, we try to have the environment that we work in to defend the goal in the game. And then we can work on different scenarios. Is it a through pass, or is it a distance shot, or is it a cross from the side? that gets headed on goal from close distance. And obviously, based on this situation, the range of possibilities or movements or solutions for the tasks that are confronted, the players are confronted with, are limited. Mm-hmm. If I shoot from, stupid example, maybe from 30 meters or 30 yards, mm-hmm. it's quite limited what the goalkeeper has to do or does not have to do. Mm-hmm. Like, we have a spread save, for example, for goalkeepers, where you really jump into the ball with everything you have and try to be quite big and be brave and dive into the ball. That's not going to happen if I shoot from 30 yards because the distance between me and the goalkeeper is way too high. So that's already putting constraints up on what the goalkeeper can or can't do. And then in regard to task constraints, we really need to look at what does the goalkeeper need? How complex is the situation? And then we can narrow down the goal, for example, or use a smaller size goal or vary the distance, or I shoot harder or less hard depending on the goalkeeper in goal, and manipulate these constraints without telling the goalkeeper. So a goalkeeper may save a lot of shots, but it could be based on me as a coach not shooting as hard, mm-hmm. but the goalkeeper won't know and still has to perceive what's happening and make an action really happening in the end, but without really knowing the solution to the problem before I do something. So this is how I can take the goalkeeper as one part, the individual, and take the game situation and try to merge it together and then make the situation more difficult or less difficult, depending on the individual that is performing at the moment.
Yeah, no, that I think that's a really good way to do it. And, I like the way you're right. You need to think about it from both sides if you really want to do a representative design. In your paper, you do a really good job of bringing in lots of different research and theories all together in this. So I want your thoughts. When you're doing that and pulling it all together, what are kind of the missing, if any, missing pieces you see that you let, more research we need to do in this area, kind of unanswered questions for you?
Yeah. So I think a big limitation, and you pointed that out really well in the podcast, it's that we are dealing with quite subjective ratings and quite subjective concepts. Like what you said, what is representative enough, or what is complex? What is task complexity? So it's quite, in nature, quite subjective, quite qualitative concepts. And I think what the next step for research would be is finding quantitative measurements for these training principles. And there have been some approaches, like Damien Farrow's and Robertson's paper has started really implementing some ways of quantitatively measuring periodization. And I know there's one approach to measuring information complexity or task difficulty, and to really put up a scale to measure that from, I think it's from 1 to 10, where the athlete really provides a number for each exercise, how complex it was. And I think this will be an approach to really help science and also coaches to find this optimum amount of representativeness and complexity in a training environment. And then I think a second thing that would really be helpful for this model, especially case studies, specialist coaches working in a variety of sports is trying to apply the model and really, writing about their experiences with it. And I think the model itself right now is very fine-tuned for goalkeeping. And I think I have quite good ideas how you can implement it in other sports, but expert coaches from volleyball, from basketball, from baseball would have even better ideas to implement it. And I think like this, you can fine tune the model much, much better and make it even more specific to different sports. So I think scaling the concepts to make it more measurable, and then case studies, applying the framework and really getting feedback on those applications. I think that could be a really good next step to make the model more valid.
Yeah, no, I really like that. I like the case studies, especially the, I think we need that even, with the constraints-led approach, I think as well, because it's so, there's no cookbook for it. It's so individualized and stuff. So just keep hearing different ways people are doing it. But yeah, it'd be nice to hear about yours and the model in other sports. So I guess the last question I had for you, Fabian, is what kind of future work do you have planned in this area? I know you've done a lot already on this, but what kind of the next steps you and Stephanie and maybe yourself are thinking about?
So what we have done, which is under review right now, is a case study on goalkeeping. So the POST framework gives some ideas how you could implement it into goalkeeping. Like I've applied this model for 2 years now, basically, with my goalkeepers in Germany. And we've written a case study on the application of the model and really going into ecological dynamics again as well, the part of self-regulation. So we try to frame it from this perspective and then really provide a practical case study on how to apply it in soccer goalkeeping. So that is one thing that we worked on together. And then another paper that we've just submitted. So that was a project that went on for a few months together with Stephanie Klatt, with Sarah Kate Miller, and also with Keith Davids, is an extension of the POST framework to feedback and instructions. So how can you basically as a coach use the skill training stages to provide guidance for athletes and help their search activities and training by providing verbal guidance, by providing verbal feedback, by providing video feedback, for example. So we really try to extend the POST framework to the coaching and feedback side of things to make it a more holistic thing. So like I said, the POST framework itself looks at the training design, which still should be the main teacher for all learning. But then we try to extend this POST framework to the coaching side of things. So the verbal feedback and instruction side that coaches certainly use, sometimes overuse, sometimes could maybe target better in a better way, or sometimes used perfectly already. So we really try to look at this factor. And this paper has just been submitted actually. And especially with Keith, we've done a lot of talks on this and have tried to mold it into the right direction. And I'm really excited about this paper. And then, the other project that Stephanie and Sarah Kate work on together with me are some research projects on actually measuring movement adaptability in goalkeeping. So for different training forms, like, for example, blocked and random training settings, to really look at and analyze the movement variability that goalkeepers execute in their actions.
Oh, that all sounds really great. I look forward to reading those. Those sound really interesting. I think you're right, the other feedback and one will be really helpful for coaches to kind of how to implement this framework. So that was really great. Thanks for taking some time to talk with me.
No, thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Thanks again for the great discussion, Fabian. You can find a link to a PDF copy of his excellent paper on the POST framework in the show notes. And remember, you can contact me at robgray@asu.edu or follow me on Twitter at ShakyWeights. To find out more about the podcast, please check out perceptionaction.com. Finally, to support the podcast and receive bonus materials, including written transcripts, please head over to patreon.com/perceptionaction. This is Rob Gray from ASU. Cheers for now, and keep them coupled. Got you quit.